So if you look at the open space, there are 7 talks which are there. There's place for 5 more. So I would suggest put it up there because you really get to talk, put up your points regarding the topic and attend which one you want to, which will get you interested. So if you feel that there's something that maybe does not interest you, why not put up your own point? So Anand there and Pooja there, they're standing there. They're raising their hands. So you can talk to them and put up your topic. And Sudeep, of course. All right, let's start.
Yeah. So let's get started with the lightning talks. The next speaker is a developer with 17 years of experience, self-taught. His special interests are algorithms, concurrent systems, and databases. Also, he loves open source. So this is Mr. Atul Kot, who will be talking about fuzz testing.
Hi guys. So we humans are conditioned, right? When we say make a drink for me, we normally think of something that is sensible. A computer doesn't have any sense, it has to be taught. So lemon juice plus milk, tea leaves plus black salt. That's a drink nobody will hopefully touch, but a computer can make that for you. So what is this, right? Random behavior. When we try to test a system, we design a test suite, and the data, example test data, we are conditioned to look at the, it is in a way disciplined, and we try to think of, we don't try to think of the, we are not insane, right? We don't think insanely. And that's where this technique is very helpful. It is mentioned a lot. If you know the practice of programming book, they devote a chapter, how do you test a compiler? So what you do is you throw a gibberish. You throw syntactically correct code, but semantically it's meaningless. And see what gets uncovered. So this is the crux of it. Try throwing senseless data. Hangs, infinite loops, exceptions, deadlocks, rest conditions, whatever. Let the computer go insane. So what I mean by this is, we use scripting languages to massage the data so that it is syntactically correct, but it will make the product or the application execute in unforeseeable ways, right? So you don't know which part of it gets tested, and hopefully it will uncover problems. So I will be quickly looking at 4 such efforts that I got very good results from. By doing this. The first thing was we were trying to use the open source Storm Math library. This is basically a number crunching library. And our product wanted to use that. But as goes with open source, there are no guarantees, right? You don't have money, it is their wish, right? If bug fixing. So how good is this thing? And nobody knew the Storm Math code. If you look at it, is heavy calculus, heavy mathematics. Everyone on the team has forgotten most of whatever that thing is, and we can't just quickly decide whether Storm Math is good for us or not. So the management team wanted a a confidence, level of confidence. How good is this? When it came to us, the problem, see, it can't be solved because you don't know, right? You might miss numbers which indicate which reveal a bug. Some case might get missed. So what we did was we generated random numbers. A lot of scripting languages were used to massage the numbers into a test data set. And this is like we generated expressions out of them. So each number is 26 digit, and more of them, division and multiplication, are generated. These expressions were collected in a file. Run them through TomMath, and there is another Linux people who are here will maybe knowing that there is a very good calculator which is there on Linux systems, which is BC. So BC is correct. BC is the master, correct. So we run the same thing to BC, run the same thing to TomMath, and compare the files. 30 million expressions we generated, went home, the script, Perl script generated expressions over the night, and we kept it running for over 4 days. We found that for numbers which are 27 digits, TomMath broke. It gave errors. But the requirement was up to 25 digits. So numbers which are 25 digits, the number crunching should be correct. Above that, it's okay. Now we went, and then TomMath was accepted, and we went to the market, and the product was released. But the crux is, how do you know how do you arrive at this? How do you arrive at this data, that for over 30 million expressions, digits with 25 numbers are okay, and beyond that, it breaks? There is no easy way. And this is first testing is the technique that helped us get over that. I wrote an article for Linux for You, which illustrates various scripting languages and how to come up with the first data. So if you want, let me know. I have a camera copy, I'll share it with you. There was another project which I remember. I had written most of the core multi-threaded code. And this was a typical master-slave architecture. The customer, this was a campaign manager. So you need to send a text SMS to 16 million cell numbers in half an hour. So we had clustering and whatnot, and a lot of parallel programming and everything built in. But end of the day, how does this work or not? What do you do if some race condition is there? How do we test it? The other problem is that the web service, that is what they do, is gave us some phone numbers to test. Four numbers were at all not enough for this kind of end-to-end testing. So this is one example where testing influences architecture. So we knew this from day one, that this is a problem. So the system was decoupled in such a way that we used a mock instead of web service. A mock is a file. And shell scripts run in parallel. You can spawn thousands of parallel processes very easily on a typical Linux box. And each process is a simple socket client. So the investment needed to make this happen is comparatively very low, right? You can quickly come up with a socket program in Java. You can copy paste something from Google. And you can send a number and a message to the application. Surprise was no big deadlocks. because we were experienced people. We had worked with multi-threading for many years. We knew how to steer clear of the problems. The profiler indicated log4j. This is basically a logging library for Java. And there was a bottleneck. Now, nobody would have thought, people normally think, and this is a typical developer thing, is third-party libraries are kind of okay, right? Log4j is not wrong, but the way we are using it was a problematic, because the bottleneck was writing to a file, multiple threads would come, and they would get locked out. It's a synchronized problem, synchronized area. So we used something called async appender, and the system became very fast. When I saw it with my own eyes, I couldn't believe that this bottleneck would have such a drastic effort. This is one other thing which where fuzz helped. We had algorithm written in Tickle. This is a programming language. But I needed very big trees. This was a tree manipulation routine. And where do I get the trees? So obviously directories. Directories are random trees, right? If you look at them, they are kind of, God knows, nobody thought of creating a tree when they created a directory. So there is a boost, there is a library which is very deep, almost 1400 levels. And we use those. It revealed a bug. We needed some, that was a very corner case where a regex needed to be greedier. A TCL expert from Norway reviewed. This guy had programmed in Tickle for all his life. Reviewed, he said, okay, this is fine. So without fuzz, that bug would have gone in. This is an open source project which I used to contribute to. It is a final one. It's a simplified LaTeX, and I did fuzz data testing. A hang was revealed. Then the lead said that it's a low priority. Nobody would do this kind of a mad thing. So we left it at that, but we know that there is a problem. So that is all, guys. This is very short time to cover this area. It is very rich. If you're interested and want to know more, ping me at my email ID.